Recorded Books presents Bones of a Saint by Grant Farley. Narrated by Christopher Carley. A quote from Casey Jones by the Grateful Dead. Trouble ahead, trouble behind. And you know that notion just crossed my mind. A quote from The Pardoner's Tale by Chaucer. They made the devil's sacrifice within the devil's temple. Wicked wise. A quote from the veneration prayer to St. Jerome Emiliani. We ask to be transformed into children so that we may one day enter the kingdom of heaven. Prologue. Denial. The priest climbed the trail into the foothills as the mission bell tolled matins. Lupine brushed his leg. The path disappeared beneath wild mustard, but he followed from memory. He passed a mound covered in poppies. Purgatory. He was close now. He hiked along the ridge, stopping at the base of the great oak stump, its charred limb poking at the sky. He shrugged off the backpack, pulled out the spade, knelt, and drove the blade into the mud between the roots. 17 years. He dug deeper. Why had he waited so long? He had lived as though in a trance. He dug deeper still. Denial, perhaps. This wooden handle, the dirt beneath it, the charred stump, these felt real even as the images of his own life slipped away. Something tugged at the shovel and his chest tightened. He pulled back on the handle. The blade ripped free, rising above him, trailing a shred of blood-encrusted canvas. Again, he thrust the blade into the soil. It clunked metal. He tossed the shovel aside and dug his hands into the earth and grasped the smooth surface. He tried to pray. Finally, he stood and brushed off his knees, massaged his lower back, and stared down into the valley as it emerged into the soft light. No hurry now. He studied the foothills across the valley, their shadows unfolding. The trees rose along the riverbed. He could not see the farmhouse, but he recognized the hill that sheltered it. The children had grown up in that home, but then had left the valley, had children of their own now, all but him. As the priest knelt again and reached into the earth, the tale of that summer slid into an eternal present. Like a boy's train forever looping upon itself on a figure-eight track. And always, that voice. Arcangel Valley, California, 1978. Chapter 1. Canterbury. I'm watching their faces shimmer under the neon blue of the Canterbury Trailer Park sign, that really only hums Canterbury with the E sort of wiggling on and off. Mr. Sanders would be PO'd at me for letting the sign go like that, but I don't got the heart to mess with it. Only three guys are playing over the line. Buns Bernie, Ed the Head, and Michael James Bartholomew III, who is only MJB to us. They're 17 and don't want to be bothered with a sawed-off 15, but I'm too slick to ditch. So they're sending me to deep, deep center. Under the streetlights, guys can play all night. Buns steps into the batter's box chalked on the asphalt. The first raindrops hit my face, dripping a low tide funk. No such thing as a rainout, so I grab my glove. The sign crackles and hums, raindrops waving like fishing line through Canterbury. I see her first. Roxanne's hair is blacker than the 20-coat paint job on Chaco's Impala. She parts it down the middle, and it hangs straight down around her shoulders. In that light, it's an oil-slick blue, and the way the drops bead like a slick wax job, she don't even need a hat. She stares at me with her eyelids drooping. Hey, RJ. She says it like I'm some kind of curse. She won't let go that hate between our moms. She slinks up to the older guys who are froze like Carew checking up on ball four. The chalk lines are bleeding down the gutter, but they sure don't see it. What are you guys doing? Roxanne says in that low voice she thinks is a turn on. She snaps her gum. Playing with our bats, I say. What does it look like we're doing, Foxy Roxy? Don't be gross. She turns to the other guys, and it don't take a genius to see that where she's taking them, she won't let me tag along. Not even in deep, deep center. The rain has slowed to a drizzle. She trades tongues with them for a while, but they're getting kind of tired of it. Roxanne finally pushes away from MJB, hands him his wireframe she was holding for him, and stands back like she knows she better get past first base or they'll go back to their old game. Let's go out to the old Miller place, she whispers. That's a blackjack hangout, Bun says. No one's lived there in years, Roxanne says. I don't see no blackjack sign on it. I'm hypnotized by these water drops hanging on the ends of her fake lashes. The blackjacks don't need no sign, Bun says. Everyone just knows it. Yeah, Ed the Head mumbles. There's nothing funkier than the soggy pot stench from his shirt. No one messes with them. No one. Precisely, MJB nods. Maybe you boys ain't ready. Maybe you boys just ain't up for a man's game. I know what kind of game it is she's talking about, but I can't figure why they're turned on by Roxanne. I stash our gear and tag along as they follow her like three puppy dogs toward the old Miller place. It's supposed to be haunted, if a guy is lame enough to believe any of that stuff. The Millers lost their farm sometime way before I was born, and most of the land has been sold off, so no one is busting butt to buy a house in the middle of nowhere. Rumors are that some city dude bought it, but it's been a couple weeks now, and no one showed. Anyway, no one ever moves to this valley. They only leave, if they're lucky. It takes most of an hour, but finally the guys are crouching out in the drizzle on a hill and staring down at the shadow of that house. Roxanne and me sit under an oak uphill from them. I'll go on reconnaissance. MJB means he'll go make sure no guys from the Blackjacks got dibs on the place tonight. He slides down the hill, and we wait. Finally, we hear his stupid all-clear whistle. They creep down the hill and in through a broken window, and I crawl in right after them. Roxanne Bic lights a couple candles waxed to the floor. In that glow, I see a curved banister torn from the stairs, beer bottles and wrappers scattered across the hardwood, and graffiti scrawled across the walls. There are worse hauntings than plain old ghosts. Find us some wood, Roxanne says. We'll make us a fire. She does this disco spin. It'll be so divine. The other guys tear around the house. I watch as she squats by the candles with her chin resting on her knees, her feet soaked through her rainbow-colored surfer sandals. She takes a bottle of nail polish out of the back pocket of her tight jeans, and the bottle click-clicks as she shakes it. She wipes her toes and smears another coat of that weird red-purple across her toenails. It's like her own color, Foxy Roxy purple. Her head bobs to a soundtrack only she can hear. She spreads her toes and wiggles them like a sea anemone. The guys stumble back, lugging ripped-up baseboards that they toss onto the grate. They stand staring at it. The closest they've ever come to lighting a fireplace is plugging in MJB's red crackling cellophane heater. Roxanne pushes them away and lights it. I'm standing away from them and don't bother to point out what that smoke might lure even at night. Especially at night. The guys step back and watch her. She closes her eyes and stands with her back to the fire, wet hair hanging down. She's wearing flared jeans like us, except hers are hip huggers, and she's wearing a t-shirt like the rest of us, too. But the fire is crackling behind her, and the way she looks under that wet t-shirt, well, that's not like the rest of us. At all. Except maybe Buns on account of he's fat, but that don't count. Her soundtrack comes moaning out of her now. Something about staying alive. She spins and moans. On the radio, the song sounds like a bunch of stoned chipmunks, but drifting from her, it's more like a sad, all-alone girl. Her disco spin slows and slows. She sees me and stops. I ain't putting on no show for him. It's degrading. Man, I say. You're just PO'd because Bun's got bigger tits than you. Bun's face turns all purple-red, foxy, roxy purple, but the others don't dare laugh. Bun's knows he can't catch me. I'm too slick. They'd spend half the night chasing me around that old house. Look, MJB says with that fake accent. There's no need for everyone to get perturbed. Why don't we simply play a little game of murder with RJ here, then we can get down to it. Murder is really only hide and seek for guys who don't want to look dorky playing a little kid game. Oh, Ed the Head asks.
Oh, got ya.
You must think I'm a total dork, I say. You're gonna have me hide, and then it'll be like tomorrow before one of you bothers to come looking for me. It's a standoff.
The boys wouldn't do that, Roxanne says to me like I'm one of the other guys. Honey, you and me can hide together and the others can try and find us.
Well, I figure as long as I got her, they won't be far off. Okay, I say. But don't try and rape me or nothing.
Don't be disgusting, she says.
So the guys start counting to 100 and I creep for the stairs.
No, this way,
she whispers. She leads me outside.
I know just the place.
Just the place is upstairs out of the rain, I say.
That's the first place they'll look.
Right. So I follow her. I know that's dumb, but there's nothing better than playing murder around an almost haunted house in the rain. She sneaks around the side. There's this stone shed that looks like it's sunk in the mud clear to the roof. It's even got this little pipe sticking out that could be a chimney, except it's just an air vent. A root cellar.
Help me with this?
She tries to lift the door, which comes out of the ground at an angle. It's like she's been here before. We lift the door with this kablang that if the guys don't hear, they gotta be deaf. The blackness and the cold slither up the stone steps, and there's no way, Jose, that I'm going down there.
What are you waiting for?
She asks from halfway down the stairs. Probably a big, juicy black widow down there. Then she's standing at the bottom, just out of the rain, lighting a cigarette. She almost looks like some starlet, the way she's letting out that smoke real slow and leaning on one hip in that wet t-shirt. There's a sweet smell seeping up from her. No bottle smell, this is all her. The Bic light flickers in that little stone room, and it looks just like a place where they bury people in horror movies, only the people are zombies or vampires or something, and they come out at night and suck people's necks or eat them, that kind of thing. She flicks an ash.
I didn't know you were chicken.
There's a log next to the door. A plan slaps into my head. Slam that door shut on her and roll that log over on top of the door and just leave her there. It'd serve her right for all the mean things she's done to me over the years. But I don't pay attention to that plan, because when it comes right down to it, I wouldn't lock my worst enemy down there. The guys are calling to each other from the house. Roxanne turns and stares at one of the walls, her eyebrows going up, and she just whispers,
"Oh, wow. What is it?"
She's just staring at the wall.
Far freaking out. What?
My feet take me right down the stairs to check it out. Whoever built that room made a big deal about it. Even the floor is solid stone. I look at that wall, but there's only rock and some spider webs that probably are from black widows. There's a creak and then kablang and then blackness.
Oh, I can't believe I fell for that.
I turn and feel for the door through the cobwebs, pounding and shouting.
Let me out!
Her whispers bounce all around the stones. I turn. Some of the night seeps in through the air vent. I hear her scuffle right on the roof next to it. She's there, crouched, waiting to hear me.
Let me out! And I'll just go home.
I don't believe you.
Nothing else to say.
Look, she says. As soon as I'm done with those guys, we'll come back and let you out.
I yell some more, but she's gone. Then it hits me.
She planned for this to happen. I sit in the middle of the floor, trying not to think of Father Speckler and the way he used to lock me in that coat closet at Our Lady's. A six-footer could reach out his arms and touch both walls, but my arms are wrapped around me. The room is so still and cold that I can't even shiver. Hail Mary, full of grace. I know that some fat black widow is right over my head, dropping into my hair like a loogie. The Lord is with thee. I'm rocking back and forth, just doing the Hail Marys and listening to the rain against the metal vent and smelling the old stone. Blessed art thou among women. I don't know how long I'm here. My body is light as a dried up leaf, swirling above that stone floor. The walls spreading out. And out. And out. To blackness, like forever. And I know I'm dying, and that if someone don't open this freaking door real soon and reach down and lift me out of this black place, then I will be dead. Forever and ever. Then I hover in that blackness, listening like I'm an outsider with my ear pressed up against the world. Like lying on that coat closet floor, listening to Father Speckler doing one of his "We're All God's Children" numbers on the class. Rain brushes the trees. Roxanne giggles and then sings about that staying alive. A tree claws the side of the outbuildings. Car tires crunch on gravel. Blackjacks? The car door slams. Heavy boots slide on the porch. Roxanne screams from inside the house. The guys yell. Then this weird, twisted kind of shout that's got to be a man from the car. Doors slam, then lots of running, first on wood and then on mud and grass. Someone runs right by the cellar. I suck that big breath, ready to let loose a scream, but a voice in my head whispers, "Shut the hell up." The only sound now is the faraway gong of the mission bell blown by the wind. Then silence. Not a soul. I might be trapped here forever. Then shuffling footsteps near the cellar. Circling the cellar, one foot dragging behind the other across the wet grass and mud. Not a blackjack. It stops near the air vent. All kinds of weird thoughts slap through me, like, what if it's my father's ghost? Then I'm not floating. I'm just huddled on that stone floor with the cold pressing all around me. Pressing. Pressing. And it just squeezes out of me. Let me out, please. Let me out. Someone down there. Instead of shouting, it's a hoarse wheeze. Someone down there. My breath slides around the stones. The foot drags along to the door, the sound of the log plopping over on the wet grass. The door lifts, a peek of night slipping in, and then slams back. More heavy breathing. The door lifts again and crashes open, and the night floods in. A worn black boot clumps on the first stair. I'm holding my breath. The flashlight beam blinds me. Beyond the light is something red, shriveled, a hand reaching down at me. It's so old, like a skeleton's, maybe. Like a claw. I push up out of that cellar, brushing past this old man, a stench of something sweetly sick, out into the rain, running, slipping in the mud, up and running, free. God, I run. Chapter 2. Cannibals. I'm trudging to the top of a hill in that muggy heat, my brother clinging to my back. Charlie has this way of wrapping his legs around my waist and his arms around my neck so that he weighs no more than a backpack. He knows that one day he'll be too big and I'll drop his sorry ass for good. Then I whiff wet grass and I'm back to last week. Pushing up out of that cellar, brushing past that ancient-looking dude, a stench of something sweetly sick. Running. Slipping in the mud. Cellar. Cell. Cave, crypt, I know all the words. I read how some monks spend their lives holed up searching for God, but there's no way. No freaking way to hear him through stone. A truck horn blasts behind me, but I don't look back. Nino and Smitty's flatbed with the state gates winds up the hill, clunks a gear, and passes me with Smitty riding shotgun, his head out the window like a dog and his stringy beard blowing in the wind. The dead blast from the 8-track. Driving that train, high on cocaine. Casey Jones, you better watch your speed. Smitty's tattooed arm dangles on the door and slaps the beat against the metal. Trouble ahead, lady in red. Take my advice, you're better off dead. He waves at me and grins as the truck tops the hill, puking exhaust in my face. Migrants are grabbing those truck gates so they won't fall out the open back. They won't hear no ranchera from Nino and Smitty. A guy grins from the shade of a flat straw hat and points at us. Then the others laugh. Then the truck slides down the grade. Manny's house floats in the ground fog down in the hollow. Okay, Bigfoot, it's downhill from here. You can walk. Charlie straightens his tie and follows me. He can talk, but he hardly ever feels like it. His white dress shirt and tie don't go with the blue jeans, but he always wears the same jeans, ironed with a 2-inch cuff on the left leg, and the right leg is slit neatly so it hangs to the ground over the huge right shoe. The tie is for the Corpus Christi Festival near Mission San Miguel Arcangel. Since he just did First Communion, he gets to be in this little flower procession. He's been practicing extra hard on his walking. That festival is pretty cool when you think about it. A bunch of normal people acting like cannibals chomping on God. I sniff my black t-shirt to check the funk. Then I follow Charlie down the hill. Manny's place could be a for real farm if his dad ever tried, but the fields are just dead weeds now. The only animals are chickens that lay wherever they feel like, so that Manny and me got Easter all year round trying to find the eggs, and a half dozen sorry pigs that get the eggs if we don't. There's a real house that's hardly bigger than my trailer, with this satellite dish out front that's nearly half as big as the house. Since Manny was born and his mom died, his dad just sits and watches sports. Maria and Adelita are sitting on the front porch ratting their hair. Their tits look fine through those peasant blouses. I don't feel sorry anymore for Manny having 3 older and 1 younger sister. Charlie hobbles up the steps and sits between them, and they start making their fuss over him. And I wouldn't mind trading places with him. Wouldn't mind at all. People think he's delicate. The way he looks like one of those porcelain dolls at Mrs. Elliott's Antiques and Collectibles Emporium. These blue veins web through his skin like the cracks on those dolls. But Charlie? He's as tough as they come. I turn and head to the back screen porch. The migrants have slipped away, and Nino and Smitty are already kicking back on beach chairs, a 6-pack between them, under the scrawny oak that Manny and me call the killing tree. No pig hangs from it today, but there's a whiff of old blood from the clawed bathtub sitting in the shadows behind them. Nino has the same snake tattoo as Smitty, but it looks smaller on his thick arm. Nino is Manny's blood uncle. Smitty isn't blood, but he's his uncle just the same. It's sort of like they're from one of Abuelita's tales that Manny squeezes into English for me. 2 halves, 1 dude.
Hey, hermano,
Nino calls to me. I hop up the porch steps and slip through the screen door. Manny gives me our newest greeting.
Aren't you a little short for a stormtrooper?
I answer. It's the uniform. We saber swoosh. I plop down next to Manny on the wicker. A smell of beans simmering in cast iron always fills that room. Abuelita stands in front of this Mexican dude, his face scrunched up in pain. Her face is soft skin folds. She rolls up this piece of paper into a funnel and holds it to the dude's ear. She lights a match with her thumbnail and holds it to the funnel all in one slick move.
Aye!
The dude cries and lifts his hand to rub the ear, and Abuelita slaps the hand away. He nods and grins, the pain gone, as she shows him out the door. I glimpse Teresa, who is only a year younger than us, back in the kitchen. She used to tie her hair in pigtails with berets, but now it's a ribboned ponytail falling to her butt. Then the kitchen door closes. Well, Abuelita is Manny's grandma, not mine, but I've sort of adopted her. She grabs her mug of cinnamon coffee off the table and heads for us. She always wears a black dress and these thick black shoes that clunk on the hollow floor. She grabs a chair and sits down facing us and puts the glass on the window ledge and lets out this sigh like she's too old and too tired to put up with my mierda. Then she puts her hands on her knees and leans back like she's going to start one of her tales. Her tales are about funny people, the earth and sky, animals that talk, and even witches, what she calls brujas. She tells them in Spanish with this soothing sing-song, and Manny does his best squeezing them into English for me. When we were little, we'd listen for hours. I wait, staring out at the world gone brittle through old screens. But instead of starting a tale, she pulls her chair closer and stares into me. Under the cinnamon coffee breath, she has this purplish old lady smell that I like. The way Abuelita's brow scrunches up, I'm figuring my own BO must be pretty funky after all. She stares over at Manny and then back at me. She's probably wondering for the 100th time whether she really wants her mijo hanging out with me. But it's years too late to get second thoughts about that.
This summer is going to be full of malevolencia. Not so easy for you, Richard James. You will have the big choice to make.
Full of evil, Manny whispers.
Anyone but Abuelita saying it, and I'd be thinking it was just part of a show. But coming from her, it freezes my insides. I'm seeing back to that root cellar. Something red, shriveled, a claw. A stench like something sweet, dead. My mind slips back, escaping to a safer place. The day Manny and me met in the first grade when the nuns lined up the class by height for the fire drill. And we punched at each other to decide who was the shortest, earning the glory of marching last in line. We fought at the end of lines through the next couple grades until Abuelita shamed us into stopping by telling us stories of Coyote, who jacked his friends with his mean, sneaky ways. Even though we haven't fought since then, we've stayed best friends. We're sort of the same, but opposite, what Mr. Sanders calls a paradox. I'm cursed with freckly skin while he gets brown the color of the mission pews. I got what Mom calls an auburn mop, and he gets straight black hair tied in a cool ponytail like an Indian. I'm skinny, and he's fat. I've got 5 younger sibs, and he's got 4 sisters. I lost my dad when I was 3, and his sister Teresa killed their mom just getting born. Come on, Manny. We gotta take Charlie to his festival. He shrugs and follows me out around the house to the porch. The sisters are gone, but Charlie sits smiling. Come on, Bigfoot. We could be riding bikes. Charlie can do that if we go slow, but Manny won't ride since the time he was sideswiped near the bonsai. It don't matter that we're not going in that direction. He still won't ride. Manny, Charlie, and me are halfway to the mission for Corpus Christi when Buns Bernie, MJB, and Ed the Head are standing by the road. I haven't seen them since that night in the cellar. Something isn't right. If it wasn't for Charlie hanging on my back, I'd take off. They'd never catch Manny or me. Hey. I nod like everything's cool and push past except Buns is in front of me like a wall of jello. Hey yourself. Buns stares down at me. I drop Charlie to the ground. So, what's up? You're coming with us. Maybe I can clown my way out of this. I wave my hand in front of him and chant, "These are not the dudes you're looking for." I glance at Manny and we both crack up. The Blackjacks want to see you. We're not laughing no more. My legs go weak. No point running, even if I could. Then Charlie goes still, his eyes staring into space as he finds that place inside that seems to make him invisible to strangers. It's like his own superpower or something. Where? I gulp.
Up there.
Buns points across to the hills edging the valley. We can't see it from here, but we all know he's pointing to Dead Man's Gorge. No one is allowed up there unless he's Blackjack. Ed the Head and MJB are silent like the place is some kind of freaking shrine. So why would the highest one want me?
The Blackjacks are PO'd at that old city dude for buying the Miller place. He stole their best flatland hangout, and worse, he's an outsider. You and that freak are connected, since he's the one that let you out of that root cellar.
What? How'd they know about that? Was he really just some old dude? I couldn't say for sure, but he seemed like a hell of a lot more than that.
Buns shrugs.
You told them. I answer my own question. What had Abuelita said? So, what's it got to do with you three?
You ask too many questions, Bun says.
I wait him out.
You're a part of our initiation. You guys? Blackjacks?
Don't make me laugh.
Come on,
Buns orders.
Wait.
No point in Charlie coming. He can't make that climb. You know that.
Ed the Head looks away from me and sucks air like he's toking.
MJB cleans his wireframes, but Buns just crosses his arms and stares at me.
Charlie is on his way to the Corpus Christi Festival.
I rush on before Buns can slip in a no.
He's in the procession. You can't make him miss that. It's like a sin against God.
Oh, crap, Ed the Head groans. His family is lapsed, and they're almost always the most afraid of God's wrath.
Let Charlie go.
You think I'm stupid?
Buns demands.
It's Thursday. Church is on Sunday.
Well, I say, this festival is on Thursday, and there ain't nothing you can do about that.
He's right, Ed says.
We got our orders, Buns says. Charlie comes too.
He's making Charlie come because he's figured out the best way to get to me is through my brother. Buns has hated me since even before I said that stuff about him and Roxanne's tits.
Okay, then why, Manny? Ace did not say anything about this other fellow,
MJB says.
He may even be perturbed at us for bringing unauthorized personnel.
Buns is trying so hard to figure it all out that his face is scrunched up like he's constipated.
If you're going, RJ, then I'm going,
Manny says. That's the bravest words I ever heard anyone say. Man, what a long, strange trip this will be.
Chapter 3. Blackjacks. We're hiking up the foothills to Dead Man's Gorge just so we can worship some psycho stoner they call the Ace.
Buns goes first. I follow with Charlie hanging on, clutching my neck.
Manny is right behind me.
MJB is after him, making sure we don't get second thoughts. Finally, Ed the Head huffs and puffs back where we don't have to whiff his homegrown.
Mr. Sanders would have called us a pilgrimage.
We climb the trail into the foothills, and I can see clear across the valley to the hills we call Big Mama. They look like a lady lying along the coastals with huge jugs sticking straight up in the sky, just like she was getting a for-real tan. Which is funny, since her weeds are just starting to turn brown for summer. The shadows even give her some soft skin folds. My t-shirt is already soaked with sweat where Charlie is hanging on. We march along and my stomach hollows as I remember all the Blackjack rumors. Beatings, hazings, robbery, protection, drugs, rape, and murder.
There could be bodies buried up here going back 100 years, clear back to Coyote Jack himself.
The Blackjacks hardly ever get caught and never once convicted. No one climbs up here uninvited. No one. And no one dares to testify. Years go by. Faces grow up and then leave. Some of them find their way out of the valley. Others melt in with those that went before and then become a part of our little world. but there's always new boys to replace them. There's always the Blackjacks. A whistle skips down at us from way up Dead Man's Gorge. It's gotta be some kind of lame signal. I feel this slimy kind of honor to be climbing into this darkest place. We reach the top of the ridge and walk along a trail with the whole valley there below us. Those farm and machinery buildings look like metal dice tossed across the fields. In an hour, they'll be floating in heat waves. Buns stopped again. He's pointing to a rock slide below the trail. The earth humps up like some kind of big animal is buried there. Buns picks up a stone and throws it. It makes a hollow thud against the mound, kind of like hurling rocks at the old water tower on Mission. My stomach flips just hearing a sound like that coming up out of the ground. See that latch there? Buns has that low voice guys use when telling stories like about the ghost with the golden arm. A metal latch sticks its head out of that hump of rocks. It's all peeling yellow and rust. There's a padlock clamped to it.
It's one of them old water trailers like the farmers used to use, Ed the Head says, messing up Bun's story.
Right, Bun says. But no one knows how it got up here. It's a mystery, like those giant stones over in New York.
England, MJB says.
Whatever. It's some kind of mystery only the ace knows about. If someone messes up, they get locked in there until he decides their punishment. He calls it purgatory.
Sounds to me like that is the punishment.
Come on, let's get this over.
I pushed past Buns with Charlie still on my back. The hot air wiggles on top of the rocks and dead weeds, and I'm feeling dizzy. I climb over a rise, and that huge oak tree is there, maybe a football field ahead of us. Of course, I've never seen it before. Well, maybe I caught the shadow of the tip-top branches one time when I telescoped it from far below, Manny not daring to even put his eyeball to the lens. It's the oldest, biggest living thing in the whole valley. Its branches spread like creepy fingers against that empty sky. I almost step on three guys lying in the shade of a boulder. One of them is Bobby Martin. He's just a year older than me. We used to hang out together. Most of the time, he'd be an okay guy, like when he'd share his Twinkie at lunch. But then he'd do something gross, like take insects or lizards or mice and put them in coffee cans and then drop in a firecracker. One day, he found this litter of kittens up in the hills. It was his find of a lifetime, and I knew there was no way to talk or even punch him out of it. So I told him to go for the ladyfinger firecrackers, and I'd watch the kittens until he got back. Of course, by the time he got back, me and the kittens were gone. After that, we hated each other. I hadn't seen him in a couple years, mostly because he went to our ladies that I'd got kicked out of. It only takes one look to see that the bad part of him has taken hold, and there's nothing left of that guy who'd share his last Twinkie.
Come on! What are you waiting for?
Buns has slipped by me while I'm spaced out. I step past Bobby and we pretend we don't know each other. All the time, I'm seeing that oak tree through the corner of my eye. Three guys could spread their arms out wide and not even reach around its trunk. There are two huge roots, each split down the middle, sort of like a goat or pig foot. Like the tree is just towing that dried up dirt to keep from falling over the edge. It's still a good 50 yards off, but I don't want to look at it, so I'm checking out the younger guys sitting in the shade of a boulder. Some of them can't be more than 11 or 12. They must be what the Blackjacks call the deuces. If you're a Blackjack, you live at home, go to school, or have a job in the valley, but this place gets inside you. This place is where you hang for real. Platforms are nailed to a couple stumpy oaks with 16 or 17-year-olds dangling their legs over, staring down at us. They're the jokers. They just watch as we pass. Manny is beside me now. A narrow gorge cuts into the hill, and a camp has been set up with a big tent and pup tents and a campfire and ice chests and all kinds of cool stuff. The older guys live up here for weeks at a time in the summer. It makes me sick seeing this awesome hangout twisted into something creepy. Manny is trying to look cool, but he's shaking. I punch his shoulder. He manages a grin.
See, Se puede, he says. Don't know what that means, except it's got to do with the farm workers. Nino says it, so it must be cool. I nod. We pass the camp, and as I get closer, I see where the trunk of that huge tree was hit by lightning a long time ago. Two smaller trunks grow out of that black stump. At the bottom, the trunk looks okay, but then they start twisting with these black sort of veins running through them, like the bad part is creeping into the new. The guys kicking back near that shade are the oldest and meanest yet. My back is so slick with sweat now that Charlie is choking me just trying to keep from sliding off. I stop at the edge of the shade. Charlie slides down. Don't go in there, Manny says. I glance at Charlie and squint my eyes, hoping he'll catch the signal and do his invisible thing, but he's too scared. I feel my feet stepping into the shadows. It's dead quiet. The air don't move at all, so that it feels all stuffy and even hotter than out in the sun. No one dared nail a platform to this tree. There's one of those rattan chairs with the fan backs set deep in the shade between the roots. The ace has one leg of his old jeans over the arm of the chair with his cracked and muddy cowboy boot just dangling. His elbow is on the other arm of the chair with his chin resting on his fist. He's wearing a torn t-shirt and a Raiders cap. He don't look any real age, but stories have the ace as 21. The way he just sits there, he almost looks like an old puppet waiting for someone to pull on the strings. Most of the other older boys I've seen somewhere over the years in this valley, like at school or working some nothing job or just hanging out. But I've never laid eyes on this guy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.